Welcome viewers in our YouTube Learning for Knowledge channel. Today we will talk about the fouling and its types in membrane filtration process in water and wastewater treatment. This is a very important aspect and very important thing to understand about the fouling, its types and why it occurs during the filtration process. So in this video I will also describe the different types and their reason for occurring of the fouling in the membrane. Now membrane techniques like microfiltration, ultrafiltration, nano and reverse osmosis, which are now widely used in water and wastewater treatment, and the major important and very important application of membrane process is the reduction of the permeate flux over time as a result of membrane fouling. That is, with the passage of time, our major impediment during the application of this process is that after passing some time, permeate flux reduces, and this is mainly due to the membrane fouling. So membrane fouling basically presents the significant challenge in membrane technologies like RO, NF, UF and MF. All membranes used in reverse osmosis process are either in nanofiltration, lost their performance and foul with the passage of time. This issue of membrane fouling is basically unavoidable issue, and this is basically impacting the filtration process and reverse osmosis. So to get the extended possible surface life out of membrane filtration, it is important to understand the fouling, reasons of the fouling and why membrane fouling occurs, and how we can avoid or reduce the fouling of the membranes. So in this video or in lecture, we will describe fouling, common types of membrane fouling and their reasons for occurring. So first of all, I will describe the fouling. Generally, fouling is basically the buildup of undesired deposits which are present in the membrane, and these particles which are present in the membrane, or you can say the impurities present in the water, they deposit on the membrane surface or inside the membrane pores. And this, what will happen when these undesirable substances deposit on the membrane, causing restriction of water flow from membrane and result in the reduction of permeation flux, quality of permeate and an increase of transmembrane pressure. The factors which are affecting the membrane fouling are mainly membrane properties like pore size, hydrophobicity and material of the membrane, adsorption of solutes or colloids within or on membrane surface, deposition of sludge flocks on membrane surface, formation of cake layer on membrane surface, and special and progressive changes of cake layer composition during long term operation. Example, different bacteria develop on the surface of this due to presence of these cakes on the surface of membrane, and biopolymer components changes with the cake layer. These are some factors which affect the which cause the membrane fouling. So membranes, whether they are reverse osmosis or nanofiltration, are susceptible to fouling via different mechanisms. So basically we normally categorize these foulings in four categories. First, biofouling, which is biological and also called microbial, then organic fouling, inorganic scaling. This is also type of fouling, but normally we'll deal separately. Inorganic scaling, which is scaling or precipitation fouling, and then colloidal and particulate fouling. This is a picture which I took from a book and now presenting you. which shows accumulation of these solids and organics on membrane surface. First of all, I will explain biofouling. What is biofouling? As it is clear from its name, biofouling is a process of microorganism adhesion and proliferation. That is their development and further multiplication on membrane surface or in the pores. So it is basically the formation of biofilm to an unacceptable degree, which could cause huge operational cost. And biofouling is more complex than other fouling types, and there are basically two components involved in this fouling. First, the bacteria or algae or microbiological substances, and then extracellular polymeric substances, which are abbreviated as EPS, and which are which are excreted by bacteria during the metabolism process. So biofouling is basically formed by microorganism, and microorganism can grow and multiply on the surface of membrane, and if proper pre-treatment if pre-treatment could not remove 100% of the bacteria, the remaining bacteria which passes through pre-treatment process stop at the membrane and can grow on membrane surface and cause membrane fouling. For biofilm, and they form a biofilm on the surface. For a biofilm formation, basically there are two conditions are critical. First of all, presence of bacteria. That is, the bacteria which passes through pre-treatment setup and then stop at the membrane, and now they are present for multiplication. Secondly, presence of nutrients. Bacteria need something to eat and then multiply. So basically bacteria and their food, these are basically two conditions. So if all the nutrients are removed from the water during pre-treatment process, then the remaining cells could not multiply due to the absence of food. So we can say either you remove the food for bacteria or remove the bacteria, you can avoid this biofouling. So in short, if I summarize this, if nutrient level is higher, vulnerability of membrane biofouling will be more. So, or other way around, if there is no nutrient available for the food of the bacteria, there will be no biofouling will occur. Second type is organic fouling. Now, organic fouling, as it is clear from its name, is the accumulation of carbon-based material on a filtration membrane. Natural organic matter consists of carbon-based compounds like humic acids, protein, polysaccharides, lipids, etc. Usually, these natural organic matter, which are also written as NOM, is used for surface water or seawater, while for the wastewater effluent, organic matter is EFOM is often used. So these two terms are used for surface water or seawater, NOM, and wastewater effluent organic matter, which are present in the wastewater, is EFOM. Organic matter is often quite reactive, and the risk that it poses as a foulant depends upon a number of factors, including its affinity for the membrane material and molecular weight of organic compound. Organic fouling could result in significant flux decline. Of course, each and every type of fouling result in a declining of the flux, but organic fouling result in a significant as compared to other or a membrane, as it is hard to eliminate due to the complex structure formed by dissolved organic matters in combination with other substances. So control of organic fouling, basically how can we control this organic fouling, and it can be minimized by implementing the following scheme. Number one, raw water treatment through some UF, applying UF, or you can say carbon filter and multimedia filters. And selecting a membrane material that resists absorption of organic material to the membrane. So a membrane, we should select a membrane material which cannot like the organic material, so it resists the absorption of the organic material on its face, or you can say on this membrane. So now I will explain natural organic matter. You can see, think that this is the natural organic matter, it is the food for bacteria. So if you remove natural organic matter, you can avoid the growth of bacteria as well as the organic fouling. NOM, NOM is a complex heterogeneous mixture of compound, you already know, and it is a result of decomposition of animal and plant material in the environment. NOM in natural water significantly influence many aspects of water treatment, including the performance of unit process, that is oxidation, flocculation and adsorption. So application of disinfectant and biological stability. Basically, if we have a less organic matter present in the water, then our flocculation process, application of disinfection and biological stability, these can be achieved much better way. If there is a more organic matter, we have to focus more and we have to apply more disinfections, and we have to focus on pre-treatment more effectively to control this natural organic matter. Basically, there are at least three fouling mechanisms due to NOM, NOM. First, the NOM might absorb in the membrane pores and narrow or block the passage ways available to the water. Very worst point, it might block access to the pores by forming a separate gel layer on the membrane surface. When it sticks on the membrane, it will form a gel type layer. In case both NOM and particles are present, it might bind particles together to form a low permeability particle and NOM layer on the membrane surface. So you have a RO membrane, and then due to these NOMs and these particles which now bind together, they form an other membrane which will stop flowing of the water. Third type is particulate and colloidal fouling, and colloidals are basically fine suspended particle, and their size are varies from nanometer to few micrometers. And colloidal or particulate fouling occurs when suspended solid or colloidal material clog the holes of the membrane. They will block the holes of the membrane or deposit on its surface. A particulate accumulate on the membrane, they form a cake. Once few particles come, another particle come, after some time they will make a cake layer that obstruct water from flowing through the membrane pore because they block or clog the pores. The cake layer formed by the deposition of colloids on the membrane surface could lead to, there are some phenomena which occur due to cake formation or due to deposition of colloids. Increased hydraulic resistance. Second, concentration polarization between the raw water and the permeate, decrease of permeate flux because it will block the flow of water and there is less area available for the water to flow, and increase of operating pressure and energy. Once there are pores are blocked, your pressure, transmembrane pressure increases, and we need more energy to produce the same amount of water. So there are again two types of colloidal foulants. Inorganic foulants, which include aluminium silicate, minerals, silica, etc. Then second type is organic macromolecules, include polysaccharides, protein, etc. Colloidal fouling could be influenced by many factors such as colloid size and shape and charge, as well as interaction with ions on the colloids. Because colloids have some partial charge, small charge, when they interact each other, they bond each other, and they can bind with the surface of the membrane due to these charges, and their size and shape also plays an important role. Mechanism of particulate fouling. Pore blocking basically is the first step in which these particles sit down or fix in the pores, and they will block the pores. So standard, there are three different types of pore blocking. Number one, standard pore blocking, it is very common, the narrowing the pore opening due to deposition of particle around the pore entry, so it will reduce the size of the pore. Complete pore blocking, pore sealing, said the particle of the colloidal or particulate of the same size as that of the pore of the membrane, so it will, if this particle sit on this, it will block and plug the pore. Intermediate pore blocking, so this is basically a combination of the first and two pore blocking mechanisms. So as the some pore are completely blocked and some are partially blocked in standard pore blocking, so they build up and more deposited the particles begins to bridge the pore openings. So like if one particle half block the pore, then second will come and it will block the remaining part of the pore. So they will basically bridge the openings. As additional particles continue to deposit on the initial layer, so a layer will be developed in the next stage. As soon as the cake forms, the cake layer will control transport and removal and effectively takes over the role of the membrane. So there is an other layer, or you can say an other membrane. Now this membrane, which is formed due to cake formation, now control the process of filtration. So it is observed that the rate of flux decay increased with increasing transmembrane pressure, which is TMP. What this means, that rate of flux decay increase. As we increase the pressure, what will happen? More colloidal particles start depositing on the cake. So further decrease in the flux, which could cause the thickness and compactness of the cake layer, because more particles are now sticking on the cake. So at high transmembrane pressure, more particles accumulated, as I explained this on the surface. The measure of the relative risk of particulate colloidal falling, one of the best technology or test is the SDI test, which is silt density index of a feed stream. We measure the SDI of the feed stream and decide whether this water need more pretreatment or not. This water required more pretreatment or not. Normally, the best thing is that SDI value must be less than 3. This is ideal. As it goes down, further down, the problem of particulate scaling or colloidal scaling reduces. So SDI measures are especially important when installing RO system, as these have the smallest pores of any membrane filtration. The SDI testing or SDI test, silt density index measurement, I will try to explain this in another video and explain the process and its effectiveness, how this test can be conducted. But the value of SDI at this moment with regard to this video is very important. So in short, particulate falling can typically be prevented by applying appropriate upstream coagulation and filtration. If we have a suitable coagulation, during in the coagulation, what we can do is we can increase the size of these colloidal particle by applying some chemical which captures this colloid particle, and colloidal particle by the process of coagulation can be stopped before it will enter in the RO membrane or any type of membrane. Now fourth and last one is scaling or precipitation fouling. Scaling, basically also known as inorganic or precipitation falling, and it basically refers to the precipitation of those salts which attain their maximum solubility at the surface of the membrane due to the gradient, or you can say due to the increase in concentration or and stoppage of the salts in on the surface of the membrane. When water reach at the surface of membrane, it stops some salts. If they reach at their solubility level, they will deposit and come out from the water and deposit on the membrane surface. So you can say refers, it is basically the precipitation of sparingly soluble salts onto the membrane surface or inside the membrane pores, often exacerbated by concentration polarization. So we can define membrane scaling occurs when dissolved constituents or salts precipitate out of solution and collect on the membrane surface or lodge in its pore. What this means? They will basically deposit on the membrane or stop on in the pores of the membrane. So RO system with feed stream has significant calcium or magnesium concentration are at particular risk for scaling. So furthermore, compared to other elements, iron could deposit on the membrane much more easily. So basically calcium, magnesium and iron are originally the main threat. If these are present in high concentration, there is a much more probability of the scaling on the surface. This can be stopped by other mechanism like appropriate pH maintaining in the raw water feed. So the factors which could affect inorganic scaling on membrane are membrane triads, that is the membrane characteristic. So composition and quality constituents of feed water, what are the present and what are the salts are in the feed water, and operating conditions on what pressure and flow rate you are operating the plant. So this is the picture which shows the scaling on the membrane surface or accumulation of scale on the membrane brine spacer. So the scaling propensity of a given feed water is usually evaluated by the Langlier's saturation index, LSI, for brackish water, and if we are using sea water, then this is another index which is known as Stiff and Davis stability index. Maybe in some other video I will try to explain separately these indexes and their uses to determine the quality of water. Control of scaling problem. How we can control the scaling? Reduce the water recovery factor to operate below solubility limit. What this means? Not apply much more pressure, get low, reduce your efficiency, so you cannot, get the more water, and in the rejection more water will go and it will take the impurities and salts. So if you increase the pressure, what will happen? You get more water, but the concentration of these partially soluble salts increase at the surface and they will start depositing. Secondly, if we have a calcium and magnesium are available in this feed water, then decrease pH by adding acid to regulate the calcium carbonate speciation, because if there is a much higher pH, there is a greater chance that calcium carbonate will deposit on the surface. So try to operate the reverse osmosis plant below 8.3 pH, and so that you cannot make bicarbonate cannot be converted into carbonate, and the solubility of carbonate are much less than bicarbonate. So if pH is less than 8.3, around 8 or less, there is a less chance that calcium carbonate will form and it will deposit on the surface. So basically what we are doing, moving solubility equilibrium towards the formation of carbonate and bicarbonates into carbon dioxide, and add inhibitors or antiscalant that delay the induction time of precipitation. So if you add some inhibitor or antiscalant, it will capture the calcium or ion, or it will, so it will increase the time for the precipitation, and it will not get time to stop, or you can say deposit on the surface. It will go out with the concentrate or reject, and eliminate calcium and magnesium to limit the risk of calcium magnesium. Or if you want to, there are much more calcium and magnesium and you think that these cannot be controlled by the above strategies, then you have to install some softener which can remove calcium and magnesium. So these are the references which I used during the preparation of this video. Thank you very much So I will try to explain some of the phenomena and scaling and other thing in detail, maybe in the coming videos, and also the LSI and Stiff Davis indexes in the future, so we can much more focus on the water treatment and understand the complete process of water treatment. Thank you very much.